appeared in blazing sunshine after rain. Tell me about it.
Well, it was given to my grandmother when she was 16 in 1915 by her great-aunt Alice, who was born in 1860.
1860, so I think that's bang on when it was made, actually. There's plenty about it that, to inform us of when it was made. It's set in silver and backed in gold, which is a signpost of the fact that it's mid-19th century and not from 1900. But all that's a bit technical because it's an incredibly beautiful object, isn't it?
I remember being fascinated with it as a little girl as well, but never dreaming it would be mine at some stage.
It's a piece of English jewellery, I think, without any doubt at all. And surprisingly, it may have been part of a run of stars, a constellation, no less, because it may have formed the centre, or at least the flanking parts, of a 19th century tiara. And the evidence of that is the fixture on the back, which is there to unscrew. And there isn't much evidence that it could be worn as a pendant because it's rounded and wouldn't sit flat against the wearer. So we have to consider that it was at least a cone to go to decorate somebody's hair, or the centre of a very much larger tiara, which was probably taken apart and distributed amongst the family at some stage or another. And what a hugely effective piece of design, so simple, my goodness me, I think anybody would be very pleased to buy that for maybe £5,000 today.
Right.
And it would be a great bargain.
Amazing.
And there's no hope of them getting it.
No, not at all.
No. I do. A star hall in exactly the right place. Fantastic.
Thank you very much. What is this piece of the Arctic doing in Burley House?
We bought it in Ottawa 40 years ago, thereabouts.
I think it was $50.
Really?
Yes.
So this is a piece of Inuit carving. We used to call them Eskimos. We don't use that term anymore. I noticed there's a sticker here on Eskimo art, but actually we call it Inuit. It's carved soapstone. The fascinating thing about Inuit art is that it was started in the 1950s, really. I mean, it didn't. Very little of this carving was done before 1950. This is by an artist called Henry Napertuck.
Yes.
And the fascinating thing I love about this is that it's the hunter and the polar bear. Now, Henry Napertuck was known as a transformation artist, in that you had the human and the polar bear. The Inuit really respected polar bears. They respected their power, their strength, and they believed that they could, if they killed the polar bear, they could take his power onto themselves. So it was quite a shamanistic view of the polar bear.
Yes.
And of course, what I love about your carving is that you see you have the transformation in the carving, in that if you look at it this way, the hunter is in charge of the polar bear. He is taking the power from the polar bear. If you turn it this way, the polar bear is in charge, and he is taking the power from the hunter. So it's actually the story, the shamanistic story of the Inuit is in this carving.
Yes, we just put it down as whether you're an optimist or a pessimist who's winning, but obviously it has a much more historical root.
I think that's a good